Well, how about that? How about Rodeo Sunday, huh? Wow. How great is that? Well, I hope you're having a good time. If you're a Presbyterian, you're struggling right now. I get it. But you'll get over it because you're going to have so much fun. This is a good time. How do y'all like the shirt this year, huh? I did my best. That's it. Well, welcome. I'm glad you're here. I hope you're, if you're visiting with us, you're not too scared off. We do this every year. You know, in our city, the Houston Livestock and Rodeo comes to town. It's the biggest thing that happens all year, and it's a lot of fun, and we just want to be part of that community, and so we celebrate in a big way here, so I'm glad you're here to celebrate with us. I like just about 1 week of country and western music, so it's perfect, and some of you like a little bit more, so welcome to those at Missouri City at the Elkins High School. Welcome. I'm glad you're there. Go by and see Scott Denton. He'd love to say hi to you. He's probably wearing an ugly shirt as well. And I want to welcome all those watching online, especially my mom who watches up in Garrett County, Maryland. She got on to me because I did go to Cuba, got back, but I caught the flu on the way back from Cuba somewhere. And I called my mother for some sympathy this weekend. Mom, I got the flu. And man, and she said, aha, I told you to get a flu shot. She just would not. I said, I called for a little sympathy. She said, you're not going to get it from me. And next year, you get a flu shot. So, Mom, I promise, next year, I will get a flu shot. Well, Cuba was amazing. It was a great deal. We got to work with some pastors down there. As you know, last year, we had a big deal. We shipped 10,000 Bibles down to Cuba, and it took us 2.5 years to get permission to do that. And we finally got it. So we went down there to work with the Eastern Baptist Convention, which is one of the larger Christian denominations in Cuba, and we wanted to see and meet the pastors and see where our Bibles were, and so we toured with this guy named Oz Bell, who's the president of the Eastern Baptist Convention and a humble servant of God. I think we have a picture of Oz Bell, me and Oz Bell, holding up one of the Bibles, and he was thrilled. They're such high-quality Bibles, and they really, it's such a humid climate. You got to have really solid Bibles. And so that was good. And he took us and toured us around to different pastors, different churches. One of the ones, which we have a pastor, Alfonso, who was so grateful. And the way they're receiving these Bibles and distributing the Bibles is they only have enough Bibles, even with 10,000 shipped in, to give new believers who were baptized a Bible. So we are very encouraged. They said it's a great encouragement that we finally got some Bibles into the country. But we need more. And so we're going to try in April to ship another container of Bibles to Cuba because they need them desperately. We're hoping we're on quite a roll there. And we're very excited about what God's doing there. But here's the thing I came back with, too. Can I ramble on just a little bit about my trip? Because I don't have much of a sermon. And I got a little bit of one, but it ain't very good. My wife told me it wasn't. But here's the deal. I've been sick, okay? Give me a break. You know, I came back. The United States of America opened an embassy there. And we got to go to the embassy and meet the guy that's in charge of religious affairs there. And I came back from that meeting with a deep appreciation for the separation of church and state. In this country, we think about that in terms of the state is absent and void of the influence of the church, but that's not really what it was intended to be, because in Cuba, there is no separation of church and state, and the state controls the church, and it's got such oppression on the church, and it is so stifling, and boy, I just came away appreciating our country and really wanting to fight for the ability for the church in Cuba to thrive. They can't build a structure on their own. All the churches that we start are in homes of the pastors, because the state will not let them build a structure called church. And so we're grateful. So please be praying for our friends in Cuba. I'm going to tell a story in my sermon about one such great pastor that that we got to know down there very, very well. Well, we're in the book of Psalms, and we've been doing the Psalms for the last 4 or 5 weeks. And today we're going to do Psalm 139. And if you have your Bible, you can turn there. There's a Bible under the chair, or we'll put the Bible verse up on the screen. We make it as easy as possible. Psalm 139 is a psalm that people quote quite a bit, or a piece of it will look very familiar to you. But as I was reading this psalm, I was reminded of three great principles for relationships, mostly in our relationship with God. Now, what we believe and what David wrote in this psalm is that God took the initiative in building a relationship with us. And he lists three things in general terms, I kind of summarize it, that we can not only appreciate in our relationship with God, but also build in our relationship with each other. And so I'm going to read Psalm 139. Are y'all with me? Missouri City, you with me? Okay, we can't hear you. Sorry. Okay, so here we go. And let me read. It starts in 139, verse 1. It says, "O Lord, you have searched me and known me." Now, that's the opening sentence. Now remember, this is poetical literature, which means it's written differently. It's not a narrative. Psalms aren't a narrative. It's not a chronological order. He's trying to dig deep into small places, right? He's trying to go deep with some small subjects. So the first sentence here is the premise for the next few verses. It says, "You've searched me and you've known me." And then the next five verses, he's going to tell how he knew him, okay? So this is a powerful thing. He says, "You know me. You know me when I sit down. You know me when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are always acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether." In other words, you know what I'm going to say before I say it. And that made me angry. Because I'm thinking, God, why don't you keep me from saying those dumb things? You know it's about to happen. Why do you let me say those things? But I got over that. Okay. "Oh, Lord, you know it all together. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it." Excuse me. This is going to get gross. Anyway, I'm sorry if you're sitting here on the front row. And maybe in Missouri City, they'll show slow motion of something coming out of my throat here. So, but here's the key in David's intimacy with God. Remember, David's described as a man after God's own heart, okay? And he described this intimate relationship, and he's reflecting on this relationship with God. And the thing that pops out at David is that God knows him better than he knows himself. He knows everything about him. In fact, that idea of "you hem me in before me and after me" means you've kind of captured me. You've caught me. You know me so well here. And he's just blown away that this idea that God knows you. Now, that's the idea. You know, closeness happens in our lives with people who we know and who know us. In fact, when strangers come and criticize us, what's the thing that we say? "You don't know me." I get criticism from time to time for certain things, and I'll just say, "Why don't you have coffee with me before you criticize me? Because you don't know me. You don't know my heart. You don't know my life. You don't know my family. You don't know my pain. You don't know my mistakes. You're just taking a glimpse of something you've seen, and you've extrapolated it into some theory about my character. Why don't you get to know me?" Because knowledge is king in building trust, in building a friendship, in building a relationship. That's the thing I've enjoyed so much, is being married for 28 years. And really, I've known my wife since she was 16 years old. We've grown up together. And I know this is an exaggeration, but I believe this is true. I just feel like I know what she's thinking. And I hate it when I'm wrong about that, because it creates a big fight, you know? I mean, and this is kind of a weird deal. As best as I can tell, I know her better than any other human on the face of the earth. And she keeps changing, and it keeps me on my toes. You know, just when I figure her out, she changes differently. But I know her better than any human, and she knows me. She knows me. The other day, I was sitting around, and she said this a couple weeks ago. She said, "Why are you so nervous?" I said, "I'm not nervous. Why do you call me nervous? I'm a man. What are you talking about? I'm not nervous at all." She goes, "You're nervous." I said, you don't know me." She said, "I do know you. I've been there." I said, "How? Tell me." I mean, I wasn't saying a word. Was sitting there watching sports. I go, "How do you know I'm nervous?" She said, "When you're nervous, you button and unbutton your shirt constantly. drives me insane. I said, I do not. She said, well, then why do you unbutton and button your shirt? I said, I wasn't doing that. Yes, you was. She said, I'll take a picture of it next time. And I knew she was right. Somehow, when I'm thinking or nervous or anxious, I said, she does know me. Dang, I got to change. You know, I mean, keep her on her toes. And I know her. I know what makes her tick. I know her love language. I know when she's happy. I know when she's nervous. I know when she's scared. You know, I know her. And she knows me like that. And it's created this incredible intimacy with us. You know, when we've been married so long, when we went on our anniversary trip to Miami, because I blew it, remember? And I planned our 28th anniversary, and I was going to Cuba, and she wasn't. You know, that was a... So we went to Miami a few days before, and I said, I know exactly what you want to do tonight. I said, on an anniversary trip, you know, you'd want a nice dinner and a fancy deal, and we were in Miami Beach, and it was nice, and I said, you want to go see a movie, don't you? She loves to see movies, and I do not care for movies. And I said, let's go see movies. And so we did, because I know her. And that's what David's talking about here. David's talking about this knowledge that builds intimacy, that creates freedom. Because not only does God know you, he likes you anyway. Think about that. You know, I mean, so often we think of God being far away, and the reality is God knows every single thought you've ever had. He knows you better than you know yourself, and he likes you anyway. He loves you, in fact. He knows everything about you, and it's powerful for David when he's reflecting upon his relationship. And so I think that's a principle for a good relationship, and the principle is this. Knowledge is key. You ought to be a student of the person you love. You ought to be a student. Don't take anything for granted. Your kids, your coworkers, your neighbors, your spouse, your boyfriend, you ought to study them and look at them and watch them and know them, because that knowledge is going to pay off, especially if you're not married. I always heard this great advice. If you're dating somebody, this is advice. If you're not married, if you're dating somebody, watch how they treat people they don't have to be nice to, because that'll be you when you get married. Am I right? So how do they treat the waiter? How do they treat the busboy? How do they treat the people who serve them? How do they treat people? If they treat those people bad because they don't have to be nice to them, that's how they're going to treat you after the big I do. You better know them, you know? And that's the ideal. And like I say, Lisa and I have gone through these different stages in life, and we always get, you have to go back to school. It's like, well, I thought I knew you. I don't even know you. You're changing. You like spinach now and vegetables. Who are you? You know, I don't even know you anymore. You know, that kind of thing. And it's that idea, that knowledge. And here's what draws me in. Because I know my wife knows me and loves me and knows everything about me and loves me anyway, then it draws this intimacy about us. It's just a crazy thing. And David's blown away by this. David is absolutely blown away, because here's what it means. God knows your deepest fears right now. He knows what you're worried about before you're worried about it. He knows your needs in a deep, deep way. He knows the grieving of your heart and the brokenness of your spirit. He knows the disappointment. He knows everything about you. And he's providing and preparing you for healing, for provision in a way that's only coming from him. I mean, it's a miracle, because he knows your needs so well. I was reminded of this in Cuba. One of the pastors that we work with is a man named Hukis. And Hukis is the president of the pastors. He's not president of the convention. He just works with all the pastors in Cuba. And we've gotten to know him over the years. In fact, he was in Houston in November, and we got to visit with him some. And Hukis is a man of God that knows how to pray. And while we were with him, he tours us around and introduces us to the pastors that we're supporting. And we were able to raise our support because of the generosity of this church from 35 to 55 pastors. So we're now supporting 55 churches in Cuba starting next month. Isn't that exciting news? And we're moving, we're hopefully next year in 2017 would even do more than that. But Hukas is a man. It's so inspiring. And we were out in the furthest part of the island in a place called Mandinga. And he got a phone call that his wife had been in an accident. And Hukas said he has to go. And he left us with another pastor to get us home. And he had to go to Guantanamo, where his wife had been put into the hospital. So we finished our tour, spent the night in Baracoa, and then we were leaving, and we were heading back to Santiago, but we had to go through Guantanamo, so we said, let's stop and check on Hukas' family. Well, Hukas' wife, Selena, had been released from the hospital. They were actually in a tour bus that had run off the road, and it compressed her back and hurt her back quite bad, but she was released, and so we went by to see him, and prayed with them. In fact, I think we have a picture of Hukas here. This is Hukas and his family. This is his wife and their two daughters, and she's recovering from the hospital. And Hukas has got a smile on his face. He was so worried. Well, after this meeting, our group got together and said that we have some money together to encourage the pastors because they're so poor, you know? So we put a little bit of money together. It was a lot of money in Cuban idea. And before we left him, because we wouldn't see Hukas again on this trip, I said, Hukas, we want to give you this to encourage your family, provide for you. And we gave it to him. And as soon as we gave it to him, he began to well up and just tear up. And so we kind of asked him about his emotion, you know. We'd given him support before. And he said, I have to tell you that I was down to my last 15 cents. Not down to my last dollar. Down to my last 15 cents. And I prayed and knew that God would take care of us, but I just didn't know how. And then you walk in, I didn't expect you, and gave this deal. And it's just a powerful deal. We're all crying. Oh, man, 15 cents, man. I mean, that is just, and Hukas was able to give a clear testimony of God knows our needs and provides at just the right time. And so often, here's the thing, man. We always think God's late, right? That why doesn't God just, instead of letting me worry about all this for a long time, why doesn't God just come through for me? And the idea is that Hukas was praying for the last 3 days, you know? He got down to his last 15 cents and said, God, I'm broke. You're going to have to provide. I got medical issues. I got to get my family home because he lived about 3 hours from Guantanamo. And I don't know how to do it. And we show up and give him some money. And it was just a powerful reminder that God knows our needs and God provides and put it on our heart to do. So what are you worried about today? That's a good thing to worry about. I don't want to take that away from you because I know you enjoy worrying about it. I do. I'm gifted and talented at this, okay? I'm like GT Worrywart, okay? But I'm just saying to you, it's a moment when you're needy. And listen, in our country, it's very difficult to get to the point of need. When was the last time you were down to your last 15 cents? So need's a relative term, isn't it? But in that need, whatever you think your need is, and it's real, it's good, that's where God's pushing you and pulling you to recognize his omniscience. God, you know me. You know my need. You know what I gotta have. You know my heart. You know my hurt. And that's what David was so blown away by, is that God knew him completely. And then he turns a corner and talks about another powerful thing about God. Here's what he says. He says, where shall I go from your spirit? It's a rhetorical question. It's, God, where can I go when you're not there? And then he gives, again, this is the way poetical literature is structured. There's the opening line, and then he gives definition to it. Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, which is the depths, dark place of suffering, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the outermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I shall say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. And the night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. This is the theological understanding of God's omnipresence. He's everywhere. Now, I know that's a concept that we humans have a hard time with. It. You're either here or there, but we have to keep in mind that God is spirit. He's not confined by a body. He can be everywhere, and he is. So, you know, I know it's just kind of the thing that we say, like, I'm going to thank the good Lord upstairs or up there. Or, you know, what did Peyton Manning say? I'm going to drink some Budweiser and thank the Lord upstairs. I mean, that's kind of just this faraway concept of God, you know? And when God becomes far away, here's the caution. When God becomes the man upstairs to you and far away, he quickly becomes irrelevant. He's just not a relevant force in your life. He's like a distant uncle you see at Christmas or Easter. Do you get the... Okay, I'm not going to say that again. Sorry. I won't use that again, but... He's like that, and David was so blown away by not only God's knowledge of him, but God's presence with him. I mean, Jesus talked about it in terms of, I'll never leave you or forsake you, and I'll stick closer than a brother. His presence is a powerful thing, and he's everywhere. In the highest of highs, in the lowest of lows, God is there. He's with you. So, I don't know about you, but there have been times, many times, especially when things aren't going well, where I felt like God was far away. Because I mistakenly associate difficulty with the absence of God and with blessing with the presence of God. And yet David takes that away from us here and he says, no, God's there. Dark's not dark to him. The darkest night, it's like a daylight to him. He's there. He's with you. You don't have to worry about his. You don't have to ever pray again, God, I hope you'll be with us. He's with you. You don't have to guess. You don't have to summons him. He's right with you in the midst of your trial and trouble. And here's the good thing about that. He sees you. He's with you. He's not abandoned you. He loves you so much that he's going to journey with you. He's going to carry you. He's going to help you. He's not far away from your problems at all. And it just kind of blows David away that says, you're here. Now, here's the relational principle for that. The first one is knowledge. The second one is your presence is needed. If you want to build a great relationship with somebody, you got to show up. In this digital age, you got to put down the phone and have what us old folks call a conversation. And you got to talk. That's the thing about Cuba that was takes about 3 days to get over. Is they do not hurry through a meal. I mean, you want to have lunch? It's an hour and 20 minutes, and it's mostly conversation. And there ain't no internet, so you got to look at the guy next to you and have a conversation with him. You know, and it's that kind of deal. That's why just about every other country in the world is much more relational than we are because, man, we're going through the drive-through window too much, you know? You can see that on my, never mind. So it's that idea of showing up and being present, not just being there physically, but emotionally and spiritually. I mean, to put down, we had a deal growing up, and every one of my kids in high school had a phone, and we just said, no texting at the table. You know, you don't bring that phone to the table. You know, we had no media Monday, which we didn't watch TV or do anything on the computer or on our phones on Mondays. And it just created this boredom that resulted an amazing amount of boredom that resulted in some amazing moments with my kids because I created the space for it. And if you're not careful... Because I get this in my office from time to time. People come in and say, we just drifted apart. You didn't just drift apart. You just quit showing up. And what happens when you quit showing up is you become irrelevant. When you become irrelevant, something else becomes relevant. And you make a trade. And the ideal here is that God's not going to let that happen with him. If you don't want it to, he's pursuing you. He's got you hemmed in. and he wants to love you, and he's going to show up. He's always there. You don't have to say, God, oh, please come, show up. He's here. He's with us. And David wanted to make sure that, and this was important for David, because David was a fellow that was pursued by his enemies. I mean, we can see that. If you read the whole chapter, you'd see a little bit of that. I mean, this guy was under pressure a lot. He knew God was with him. And that's the question for you. Do you know that God's with you? Do you know? Do you have a confidence, even though you don't feel it? See, this whole idea of a relationship with Christ isn't a feeling religion. It's a knowledge religion in the sense that you know that God is here, that you stand on the truth, and the truth is that God is with you, that he'll never leave you, that he wants to pursue you, and you don't have to summons him from afar, that he loves you just the way you are, and that builds this relationship with David. Here's a couple of things. Here's the familiar part of the psalm I don't have much to say about, but we use this a lot. For you formed me, my innermost parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Have you heard that before? Okay, good. And wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret. Intrinsically, I woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. Now, that verse, I mean, there's a lot in that thing, and I don't have the energy to talk about it all, but I'll tell you this. David's talking about the fact that God purposed him. Ever thought about that, that as goofy as you are, that God's got a purpose for your life? I mean, I think about that. I mean, as goofy as I am, as broken as I am, as silly as I am, God wove me and knitted me together, knew me in my mother's womb, and he knows me, and he put me together for a purpose. The purpose, mainly, for all of us, it's not a big mystery, is to love and to know and to serve God. It's your purpose in life. Is to center your life around your Creator, not around yourself. And the ideal here that David is saying is that you created me with purpose. And here's what blows David away, blows me away. He knows the number of days you're going to live. Don't ask him to tell you, because it might be a shocker. Like, God, how many more do I got? If you hear one more, it's just a problem for you. You're going to have a bad day, you know? The ideal, though, is that God's sovereignty abounds, that he's in charge. He knows every day that you're going to live. He knows every single one of them. He's written them down in some book. You see, that's the ideal here. Nothing is a mystery to God. And it's that kind of understanding and that kind of power that allows David to draw with confidence into this relationship with the Creator and say, Father, you know me, that you're with me, that you've created me with purpose, and I want this relationship with you. I want to be after you. I want my life to revolve around you. I want eternity to matter today. I don't want to chase the almighty dollar. I don't want to do what everybody else is doing. I want my life to count forever. I want to have hope that's eternal. I want to do something powerful in other people's lives. I want to help other people find you, Jesus. I want this life to make a difference. That's what he's saying. And I think that's what we all want. We want to know that our life counts. I think that's why many of us struggle with being a workaholic. Because we just work, work, work. And we think it's somehow at the end of the day, it'll all make a difference when we have enough money or enough prestige or enough acclaim. Something big happens, and we find ourselves sometimes just empty of that. And what I can promise each and every one of you, like David, is that God's got a purpose for you today. This isn't some award you get at the end of your life. This is something you can achieve today, that you can live according to God's purposes today. That you can say, God, what do you want for my life? You created me. You know how long I'm going to live. So what do you want from me? What do you want me to do? How do you want me to live my life? How can I honor you? How can I enjoy life the way you designed it to be enjoyed? How can that be? See, that's a reversal of what we typically do, which is we typically are asking God to bless our plan for our life. And I do that too, so don't kick yourself too hard, because I like my plan a lot. I think it's pretty good. Only do I realize when I achieved my plan, it didn't do what I thought it was going to do, do I go, okay, God, your plan. I want your plan. That's what David's saying here. You created me. You know how long I'm going to live. You have purpose for me. You knitted me together. What do you want from me? And then this last part. Let me read this last part, and we'll be done. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. See if there's any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. Boy, what a humble deal. Keep that up. Let's say this verse out loud together. You in Missouri City, would you do it as well? Just say it out loud together. Let's say it together. Ready? Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there's any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. If you'll just highlight that in your Bible, and in the morning, read it, pray it. And the next day, do the same thing. And the next day, do the same thing. Do it for a week. See if this doesn't change your perspective in life. This is a big time relational principle. Here's what it is. The relational principle that David's exhibiting here is vulnerability wins. Humility could have been the answer there, but he's vulnerable. God, search me. I'm vulnerable. I'm opening my life up to you. Search me and see if there's any grievous way in me. I think David knew there probably was. I mean, it's one thing to go, God, just check me out, man. See if there's anything wrong with me, if you don't think there is. But there's something that tells me that David was pretty honest with himself, because I've read Psalm 51 and some of the other Psalms. He knew he was a broken person. And so he says, God, just check me out. See if there's any grievous way. Bring it to my attention. Lead me in the way of everlasting. Lead me in your truth. This sense of vulnerability is so important to build intimacy with God or with others. Listen, if you can't go to God and say, forgive me, I've sinned, you'll never have a close relationship with God. If you're the kind of person, and I've been this kind of person, maybe we all are at some level, where you're constantly defending your actions, constantly rationalizing your behavior, your choices, constantly explaining away your decisions, and you've never come to the place on a consistent level that you say, God, I'm sorry. I've messed up. Man, I screwed that up. I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have thought that. I shouldn't have said that. Then you're missing something beautiful in your relationship with God, and that beauty is forgiveness. And that beauty is redemption. And that beauty is humility that creates intimacy in your life. And if the people around you don't hear that quite often from you, you're missing something beautiful. If the people in your life, if your children don't hear you say, Dad, listen, I'm talking to you now. Dad, if you don't say to your children on a real regular basis, Dad, sorry, I didn't do that well. I want to be a better dad than that. Would you forgive me? Man, your three-year-old will be so confused, you know? But that's a good time to start. You know, if your spouse or your boss or, you know, we just somehow we get our value from our performance so much that we're scared to admit our faults. And David had this vulnerability about him that built this beautiful relationship with the Father. You know, that's a principle. I've gotten really good at going to Lisa and saying to her, man, we had a little spat when I got home from Cuba. I'm tired. I'm cranky. I had this little fight. It was totally her fault. And and I just said, you know, baby, I'm sorry. I'm tired. And I'm cranky. And I shouldn't have snapped at you that. And I got to preach this sermon about forgiveness. I need to do this so I have an illustration. But would you forgive me? Now, I sincerely apologized to her, and she said, yeah, I forgive you. I She does that with me. It just lowers the defenses. Listen, if you have to be right all the time, you're going to expend so much energy trying to convince other people that you're right. The freedom isn't being right. The freedom is in being together. You know? So you can be right. Congratulations. You're right and alone. That's beautiful, isn't it? Well, I was right. Yeah, that's an incredible thing, being right. It's just not all it's cracked up to be. Being right's never all it's cracked up to be. And David was able to say, God, search me. See if there's any evil way in me. Man, can you imagine? It's one thing to confess to God the sins you know about. But this is a whole nother level. David's able to say, God, forgive me for this or that or that. But then to say, now God, search my heart. Is there anything left that I need to deal with? Is there any sin that you need to bring to my mind that I need to confess? Now, I've prayed this prayer. Let me tell you what happens. God does bring it up. Yeah, you probably need to give this a little attention. I didn't even know that was a problem. Okay, God, forgive me for that. And you want to say amen so quick, get out of that thing before God brings something else up. You know, I mean, and here's the thing, man. It's like a cleansing of your soul. And I just wonder how much baggage we're dragging around in our relationships and in our life because we don't clean that stuff out. You know, we don't say, oh, God, just search me. Now, is there something I'm missing here? Is there something I'm missing? Because I want to be right. And the last thing he says here is, lead me in the way of everlasting. That's a total surrender to God's leadership in your life. Are you ready to do that? Or do you like the position you're playing now where you're in charge and you're hoping God will bless you a little bit? Because that gets old, man. God wants to be in charge of your life. He knows what he's doing. He knitted you together. He knows how many days you're going to live. And so he wants to lead you through those days. Every one of them. And every day you take charge is a day you've missed the opportunity to be part of what God's doing. That's why getting up in the morning and saying, God, I'm yours. Lead me in the way of everlasting is an important prayer. Because it's a surrendered life. It's a surrendered heart. And God will start gnawing on you. But you need to deal with this because that's going to be freedom for you. He's going to put you in a bind, a crisis of faith, where you're going to have to either believe your way is better or his way is better. And you're going to have a crisis of faith that's going to build your strength in Christ. And you're going to have this moment where you can say, wow, I trusted in the Lord, and I did as he said, and my life is so blessed by it. And I've gone through some dark times, and God was there, and God's led me. And so that's what David did. He understood the power of an intimate life and vulnerability. I hope you can do that. I hope. I do this from time to time with our church if you're visiting with us. But I think it's important that you hear yourself say from time to time, I'm sorry. So we're going to say it out loud. And you look straight ahead. Do not look. Don't give that person the benefit of, this is just behavior modification right here, okay? So even in Missouri City, I want you to hear you say, I'm sorry. You ready? Here we go. Ready? I'm sorry. Okay, now we're going to go to the next chorus, and it's, please forgive me. Not, but you know you did some wrong too. And that's not, everybody thinks that's the next part of the sentence. Yeah, I'm sorry, but you know you did some stuff wrong too. No, that's not the second part of that, I'm sorry is, and will you forgive me? So we're going to say, will you forgive me together? Ready? Here, Missouri City, come on, participate. Here we go. Ready? Will you forgive me? That's so freeing. If the other person doesn't forgive you, that's on them. You've done all you can do. Don't defend yourself anymore. Quit insisting on being right. Be vulnerable. It's strong. It's a strong position to take. Vulnerability. What an oxymoron, huh? Just this paradox of my strength comes in my weakness. I'm sorry. Would you forgive me? It's powerful. In all your relationships, it's powerful. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for loving us, for David's words of encouragement here, for the way, God, you so built a relationship. You know us. And I know there are some here in Missouri City that aren't sure that you really know them or are around them or available to them. May today's word encourage them. If you're here or in Missouri City and you've never given your life to Christ, I always give you an invitation to do that. Because I don't want you to just buy into the program. I want you to have a moment with the Savior. And the way you do that is just to say, God, I believe. I believe that Christ died for my sins. And I believe, and I am going to be vulnerable and say, forgive me. I've done wrong. And I want you to lead my life. That prayer is the beginning of a great relationship built on grace and built on mercy and not built on your performance. And God, I know all of our earthly relationships need your help. They need you in a desperate, desperate way. May these three principles, knowledge, presence, and vulnerability, help us. And we pray all this in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. Would you have a good time in church today? Well, I don't want to be done. Let's stand up and sing one more song together. Would you stand up, please, and let's sing.
Time. Y'all have a great rest of the day.